Ok.
Era 1220 y sus auspiciadores no se solidarizan necesariamente con las expresiones vertidas en el siguiente programa.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Welcome to another episode of Islam for Mankind, coming live from radio station La Primera 1220, La Primera 1220, from the beautiful city of Kissimmee, Florida. And today we are honored to have with us a guest all the way from Texas, a special guest all the way from Texas. His name is Daniel Abdullah Hernandez, Imam of Islamic Central Pearland, Texas, and the national speaker for Islam, Islam in Spanish radio station. Assalamu alaikum, Imam. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh.
Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. So happy to have you, and it's an honor to host you in this blessed day, inshallah. So we will be speaking about Prophet of Mercy, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is so many misconceptions out there and so many propaganda that is said about Prophet Muhammad. How do you introduce this Prophet of Mercy, this Prophet of Mercy that all the prophet, all the previous prophets spoke about him in great detail, even in the Bible, we found mention about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How would you, Imam Hernandez, how would you introduce this Prophet of Mercy to mankind? And before that, if you would please introduce yourself, tell us a little bit about yourself. Jazakumullahu khairan.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, my name is Daniel Abdullah Hernandez. I was born in New York. My family is originally from Puerto Rico. I accepted Islam in 1999, and I have been studying extensively Islam since the year 2004. I went to study in Egypt. I got a scholarship to study in Al-Azhar. And currently I've been the Imam in Texas for 5 years, currently in the Pearland Islamic Center.
For those who are not familiar with Azhar, it's a prestigious Islamic scholarly, renowned scholarly. It's known all over the world, and it's very prestigious, and it's very scholarly, and it's very renowned. Continues.
If people can look up, there's two schools. One which was founded in 852, which is the school Madrasa del Qayrawan, the school of Qayrawan, which was actually founded, which is the first university in the world actually founded by a woman, and that should be enough to eliminate the misconception about women in Islam.
Not just any woman, a Muslim woman wearing hijab, a headscarf, for those who are not familiar with
that. Yes, a Muslim woman by the name of Fatima al-Fihri. So she inherited wealth, established a school, a library, and a mosque. So then after that, the Azhar University was founded in Egypt close to the year 900. And it has been functioning ever since. So this is a little bit about myself. Now, to answer the question, how do we introduce Muhammad to the general public? First and foremost, when one looks into the life of Muhammad, one looks at it from the sources that are Islamic sources, scholarly sources, because we have sources ranging, you know, from 1,400 years ago, 1,450 years ago. There's information about him that can officially be traced back down to him. There is a whole science of tracing back name by name, right, about all the way to the Prophet Muhammad. Each statement that he said is verified. And therefore, there is no other human being in history whose biography or whose statement can be traced back to them all the way until this time and day. So that's one. We have our sources that can trace back these statements and verify them. Now, when the misconceptions come about is by authors that are not tracing back these statements or verifying them in that way. They're just verifying them by the contemporary perspective. So Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, peace be upon him, he was born in the year 571. And he is a descendant of Prophet Ishmael. Prophet Ishmael, and we call him in Arabic Ismail, was the son of Abraham. And in the book of Genesis, and we have many sections in the Bible which allude to a prophet coming descendant of Ishmael. Ishmael inhabited a place called Paran. And Paran, there is the second son of Ishmael named Kedar, was called in the Bible Kedar and the princes of Arabia. Now,
Imam Hernandez, sorry to interrupt you. If you would please translate, because this is mainly a Spanish-speaking radio, and inshallah we do one in English and Spanish. So if you would please translate as well into Spanish, if that's okay.
No, I would.
Inshallah, continue. Jazakumullah.
So, primero que nada, I will just introduce myself in Spanish.
Inshallah.
Primero que nada, en el nombre de Dios, el compasivo, el misericordioso. Mi nombre es Daniel Abdullah Hernández, nací en Nueva York, mi familia es de Puerto Rico, y en el año 1999 acepté el Islam, y desde el 2004 me he embarcado en la búsqueda del conocimiento, y tuve la bondad de participar y estudiar en una de las primeras universidades en el mundo llamada Al-Azhar. Ahora, en relación a las misconcepciones o introduciendo o conociendo a Mohammed, que la paz y bendición de Dios sea con él, Mohammed nació en el año, primero que nada, uno tiene que aprender acerca de Mohammed de acuerdo a las fuentes auténticas islámicas que existen. Porque tenemos en esas fuentes cada dicho del profeta Muhammad verificado que llega desde mi persona, por ejemplo, de nombre a nombre. Yo lo escuché de mi maestro, que lo escuchó de su maestro, que lo escuchó de su maestro, hasta llegar al profeta Muhammad. Tenemos más de 30,000 dichos del profeta Muhammad verificados en 6 enciclopedias. Entonces, eso es cómo primero introducir y conocer quién es Muhammad. Now, so we have in our Islamic heritage, we have over 30,000 verified statements that are traced back down to Muhammad, peace be upon him. Now, Muhammad was descendant of Ishmael. He was raised and he was illiterate. He didn't know how to read or write. And he was known before Islam as the trustworthy, the truthful, trustworthy. People knew him by this character. So to him, God revealed to him in a period of 23 years, the Quran didn't come at one shot. It took 23 years. And now this Quran has been preserved for 1,450 years, and millions of people have memorized it, and the Quran serves as the living miracle that we have available, that every mosque has available in this day and age. It hasn't been changed, and millions of people have memorized it in the way that the Prophet Muhammad taught it.
So if I may ask you, Imam, and sorry to interrupt you, before speaking about the Quran, it's beautiful. Then can you please tell us or share with the audience, how did you discover Islam? How did you learn, being born in New York, being of Hispanic heritage, descendant of Puerto Rico? How did you discover? Yeah, go ahead.
If I can maybe suggest, maybe we can... in the next show, we can inshallah. Do it all about my life. I don't want to take my
life of the prophet.
You know, I mean, I would love to. I would accept the invitation to speak next time about my life and
inshallah.
And because it's going to take some time, and I don't want to. It has some drama. It has some sad moments, some joy. So I want to really give the time to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because Prophet Muhammad was born in this month and this week, right?
Yeah.
So we want to also take that time. Is that okay?
Yeah, that's fine. Oh, absolutely. By all means, go ahead, continue.
Okay, wonderful. Okay, so el profeta Muhammad nació en el año 571. Es descendiente de Ismael, el hijo de Abraham. Y él habitó un lugar llamado Parán. Y este lugar está mencionado en la Biblia. Y Dios menciona que el segundo hijo de Ismael se llama Kedar, y Kedar en la Biblia se menciona que es el príncipe de los árabes, y también el lugar Parán está mencionado en el Deuteronomio, cuando Dios dice, y Dios hablará en Sinaí, a quien le habló, a Moisés, y se levantará en Seir, donde Jesús dio su primer sermón. Y resplandiendo su luz en Parán, y es Parán es Arabia. Entonces, ¿quién y cuál fue el profeta que resplandeció su luz en Parán? Y a nosotros nunca se nos ha enseñado ese aspecto o la interpretación de ese lugar. Ahora, el profeta Muhammad fue conocido como el digno de confianza, y él era un analfabeto, no sabía leer ni escribir. A él se le reveló, y en esos tiempos habían poetas en Arabia y eran conocidos. Ahora, como él tenía esa reputación del digno de confianza, a él se le reveló el Corán, y el Corán tomó 23 años para revelarse completo. Y el Corán lleva preservado por 1450 años, ni una letra se le ha cambiado, y más de 1450 años, millones de personas lo memorizan, y por eso el Corán es el milagro que Dios le dio al profeta Muhammad, porque hoy en día todo musulmán que tiene un Corán en árabe tiene acceso a letra por letra, vocal por vocal, que se le reveló a Muhammad desde hace 1450 años, y como una persona que no sabía leer y escribir va a producir un libro de ese calibre. Now, the Prophet Muhammad was given the Quran, and the Quran is the living miracle that exists in the household of every Muslim who possesses a Quran in Arabic, because the Quran has been preserved for 1450 years plus, and not one letter has been changed. So every letter, every vowel has been preserved since that time. And how can a person who didn't know how to read or write produce such a book that even some science that has been recently discovered was already mentioned in the Quran? Now, I want to talk about Prophet Muhammad, a mercy to the world. So I'm going to talk about Prophet Muhammad, a mercy to the people. Prophet Muhammad, a mercy to the needy. Prophet Muhammad, a mercy to women. Prophet Muhammad, a mercy to animals. So, and I will go each point in English and in Spanish. So, voy a ahora hablar acerca de el profeta Muhammad como una misericordia para los mundos. y los puntos de cual voy a hablar. Número uno es el profeta Mohammed, una misericordia para la gente. El profeta Mohammed, una misericordia para los necesitados. El profeta Mohammed, una misericordia para las mujeres. El profeta Mohammed, una misericordia para los animales y para los mundos. El profeta Mohammed, que la paz y bendiciones de Dios sea con él, tenía un tremendo carácter. Y Dios dice en el Corán, verdaderamente tú tienes un carácter ejemplar. Una vez, y es interesante porque algunas veces dicen que los musulmanes no respetan o se llevan con los judíos, ¿verdad? Entonces, nosotros, el musulmán debe tomar el ejemplo del profeta Mohammed en cómo tratar con el prójimo. El profeta Mohammed, que la paz y bendiciones de Dios sea con él, un día pasó delante de él una fúnebre y era de un judío. El profeta Mohammed, cuando pasó la fúnebre, se levantó en respeto a el fallecido. Uno de los compañeros le preguntó: oh, mensajero de Dios, el fallecido era un judío. El mensajero, el profeta Mohammed, dice: ¿acaso no era un ser humano? ¿Acaso no era un ser humano? So the prophet, peace be upon him, one time was sitting with his companions, yeah. and he saw, and some people say that, you know, Muslims do not like Jews or do not honor Jews or respect Jews, etc., etc. But the Muslim, and this is, I'm talking to Muslims as well, has to take the example of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And we do not judge the message of Muhammad, peace be upon him, by the actions of Muslims, because sometimes Muslims as human beings act, quote-unquote, on behalf or on the name of Islam, but it's totally contradictory to the teachings of Prophet Muhammad. So Prophet Muhammad saw a funeral procession of a Jew, and as it was passing by, he stood up, and the companions automatically stood up with him. Once the funeral procession passed, one of the companions asked, oh, messenger of God, you know, it was the funeral procession of a Jew. And Prophet Muhammad said, wasn't he not a human being? So the Prophet taught us that we have to be merciful to all. And he has a statement that says, and I'm going to say it in Arabic, it says, الرحمون يرحمهم الرحمن ارحموا من في الأرض يرحمكم من في السماء. The merciful, those who are merciful, will be shown mercy by the most merciful. Show mercy to those who are upon the earth, that the one who's in the heavens will have mercy on you. Ahora, el profeta Muhammad nos enseñó a ser misericordioso, y no solamente misericordioso con los musulmanes, sino con todo, con toda la creación. Él dijo, los misericordiosos serán enseñados misericordia por el misericordioso. Sean misericordiosos con todos los que están en la tierra, que el que está en los cielos tendrá misericordia de vosotros. Now, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in his mercy towards the needy, towards the poor, one day, the Prophet, peace be upon him, came to the mosque, and the poor was sitting in one side. And he went and sat with them in honor of them. He chatted with them, he talked to them, and he gave glad tidings. And he said, the poor and the needy, believers will be the first to enter paradise. And then he said a prayer. He said, oh my Lord, make me live as the poor, and let me die as the poor, and resurrect me among the poor. El profeta Muhammad tenía misericordia con los necesitados y con los pobres. Un día, él fue a la mezquita y habían un grupo de pobres sentados en una esquina. Y él, para honorarlos, se sentó con ellos y charló, habló con ellos y le dio las buenas nuevas a los pobres. Y le dijo, en el día de juicio, los primeros en ser juzgados son los pobres. Y los primeros en entrar al paraíso son los pobres. Y él hizo una plegaria y dijo, oh mi Señor, haz que viva pobre y haz que muera pobre. Y tráeme, regrésame de nuevo en el día de juicio entre los pobres. So Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was a mercy to all the worlds, Muslim, non-Muslim, poor, women, animals, etc., etc. So the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, used to honor the woman, and he said, paradise lies under the feet of the mother. He also said, the best of you is the one who's best to his wife, and I am the best to my wife. And he honored them, and he encouraged their good treatment. And before the message of Islam in Arabia, the woman used to be forced into marriage. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, said that the woman should not be forced into marriage, but she should have the freedom to choose or refuse who she marries. The woman is an individual, as the man is an individual, and she has the right to choose. She has the responsibility to worship, as the man has the responsibility to worship. So the woman is honored and is given freedom to education since the outset of Islam, is given freedom to own her own business. When she gets married, she gets a monetary gift, and that is hers. And then her husband's money is hers, and still the husband has to maintain her, right? And this is the status of the woman.
The women are delighted to hear this message, which is often not heard because of all the, you know, the people are practicing a culture not so much Islam. And what we see, all the misunderstanding and the misconception and misrepresentations are all product of the society as at large, not Islam. Islam is far more mercy and continues. Jazakumullah khair.
Yes, so this is the true application of Islam, right? The definition of Islam is sincere submission to the divine will of God. Esa es la práctica del Islam. El Islam significa sincera sumisión y obediencia a la voluntad de Dios. And Jesus said, in the book of Matthew. He said, not the one who calls me master shall enter the kingdom of the heavens, but the one who does the will of the Father, he shall enter the kingdom. Or in other versions, the one that does the will of the one that sent me, he shall enter the kingdom of the heavens. So this is the definition of Islam. El profeta Muhammad tenía misericordia sobre las mujeres. Y él dijo, el paraíso está debajo de los pies de la mujer. Él también dijo, el mejor de vosotros es aquel que es mejor con su esposa. El profeta Muhammad nos demostró, porque en el tiempo de antes de que se comenzara a revelar el Corán, las mujeres eran forzadas al matrimonio. Y el profeta Muhammad dijo, la mujer no debe ser forzada a casarse, sino que debe tener la libertad de escoger o rechazar con quien se casa. La mujer cuando se casa recibe un dote, que se llama un mahar, un dote, y este dote es un regalo. Y ese dinero algunas veces puede ser 10,000, 20,000 dólares. Y ese regalo es para ella. Y el hombre todavía tiene que mantenerla. Entonces, este dinero es para ella. Y el dinero de su esposo también es para ella. Y si ella trabaja, el dinero es para ella. Ahora, esa es la posición de la mujer. La mujer desde el comienzo del Islam ha tenido la libertad de estudiar, de mostrar su voz en aspectos políticos y sociales. Now, when we move forward, the position of the Prophet, peace be upon him, and mercy towards animals. Because we know that we always have the topics of animal rights, right, and animal abuse, etc., etc. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, one time was walking by a garden. And when he walked by this garden, he heard a camel. Give me one second, the reception.
Yeah, that's fine, inshallah. So for those who just joined us, this is Islam for Mankind, your weekly radio program. We're honored to have with us a special guest all the way from Texas, Imam Daniel Abdullah Hernandez. Imam Daniel Abdullah Hernandez is a national speaker in of Islam in Spanish, and he is also Imam at the masjid in Texas, Pearland, the Islamic Center in Pearland. Are you with us? Are you?
Yes, I'm here. Yeah.
That's fine.
I'm using
inshallah.
The phone. I get phone calls. I have to also.
We understand, inshallah.
Yes. Okay. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, came to a garden of a companion, and there was a camel tied, and he heard the camel cry, like moan. And tears began to fall from its eyes. When the Prophet saw this, he approached the camel and patted on the head. And the camel stopped making the sound, the moaning sound. And the Prophet went to the owner of the garden and asked him, "Are you not afraid of Allah? Are you not afraid of Allah who entrusted you with this camel? The camel complained to me that you beat and torture it." So, el profeta Muhammad demostró en muchas ocasiones su misericordia con los animales. Un día entró en un jardín de un compañero de él y escuchó un camello haciendo un ruido, llorando, y cuando se le acercó vio lágrimas salir de los ojos del camello. El profeta se le acercó, le tocó la cabeza y el camello paró de llorar. El profeta fue donde el dueño del jardín y le dijo, ¿acaso tú no estás, acaso no le temes a Allah? ¿Acaso tú no le temes a Allah, a Dios, quien fue el que te dio la bondad de tener a este camello? El camello se quejó de que tú lo torturas y le pegas. So, this is an example, my brothers and sisters, friends, neighbors, of who Prophet Muhammad was and how he dealt with the people, with the needy, with women, with animals, and even with children. The Prophet Muhammad had a special wisdom, psychological impact on people, because when he spoke to people, he spoke to the mental capacity of the people. He didn't speak above the head of the people. So if he spoke with the elder, he spoke at their level. When he spoke to women, he spoke at their level. When he spoke to children, he spoke at their level. So the Prophet Muhammad used to teach the children, he used to speak in small words in order for them to understand. And he used to advise them, and he used to give them, because everyone has the right to know. Now, el profeta Muhammad era misericordioso con la gente, con la mujer, las mujeres, con los necesitados, con los animales y hasta con los niños y los ancianos. Cuando él hablaba, él tenía un impacto grandioso, porque él hablaba con el prójimo tomando en cuenta su capacidad mental, tomando en cuenta su capacidad mental. Entonces, el profeta Muhammad, que la paz y bendición de Dios sea con él, él hablaba con los creyentes de una manera, con los no musulmanes de una manera, con las mujeres de una manera, con los necesitados de una manera, con los pobres de una manera, con los animales los trataba de una manera, con los niños lo trataba de una manera, y hay muchos ejemplos más. Now, the concluding section, discuss why did Prophet Muhammad, why did Allah, God, Allah is the name of God, Dios, why did Allah send Prophet Muhammad, and why did Allah send the Quran, right? So, yes. ¿Por qué Dios? Ahora, para concluir, quiero hablar de por qué Dios envió al profeta Muhammad y por qué Dios envió el Corán. Si acaso no tenemos profetas y escrituras, sagradas escrituras. Y para clarificar, to clarify, the message of Islam does not deny the prophets and does not deny the scriptures. We cannot be Muslim unless if we believe in Moses, Jesus, Abraham, all the prophets. And we cannot be Muslim unless we believe in all of the scriptures. Okay? Now the question is, ask yourself, which of the scriptures that you read, which Bible is the authentic Bible? And is there only one Bible? And can we verify one Bible that we find it in the original language going all the way back to Jesus, peace be upon him? These are questions that we have to ask ourselves, because if we believe that God is the creator of the heavens and the earth, right? We believe that God is the creator of the heavens and the earth, that he is one, that none has the right to be worshipped except him, that he created all of the universe, then the next thing to know is, okay, I need to worship this God, right? I need to pray to this God. How do I pray? Where do I acquire my information to pray, right? So therefore, we have the scripture. Now, which scripture gives me certainty. Which scripture can I trace back down all the way to Jesus and Moses? Okay? Ahora, la pregunta es, ¿por qué razón Dios envió al profeta Muhammad? ¿Y por qué Dios envió el Corán? ¿Verdad? ¿Por qué razón, si tenemos profetas, si tenemos sagradas escrituras? Una de las razones que si creemos en Dios, con certeza Dios el creador, el único creador del universo, el dueño del día del juicio, al que no tiene semejantes, el único. Si creemos en él, el segundo paso es cómo lo adoro, cómo le rezo a Dios, ¿verdad? Entonces, para tener certeza, Dios no nos dejó desamparados, ¿no? Sino que él nos envió la Sagrada Escritura. Ahora, ¿cuál de las Escrituras, verdad? Y el Corán nos enseña que tenemos que creer en todos los profetas. Moisés, Jesús, sin, y el musulmán no puede ser musulmán si no cree en uno de ellos. El musulmán también tiene que creer, porque el musulmán es la persona que se entrega a la voluntad de Dios. Tiene que creer en Jesús y en la escritura que Dios le reveló a Jesús, el Evangelio. Y en Moisés y en las escrituras que le reveló a Moisés. Ahora, ¿cuál de las escrituras que tenemos ha sido preservada? ¿Y cuál de ellas podemos verificar en su lenguaje original que es de Jesús y de Moisés? Entonces, cuando vemos que hay diferentes versiones, ¿verdad? Ahora, para uno tener certeza en el día de juicio y que Dios esté complacido con uno, uno tiene que adorarlo como Él nos ordenó, ¿ok? Y eso debe de ser basado en la Sagrada Escritura. Now, when we look at the worship in the scripture, because we find that Islam is not a new religion, is confirming the message of Abraham, Moses, Jesus, and all of the prophets. And we see that there is a harmony in the way of worship that derived from the scripture. We find in the Old Testament and in the New Testament and in the Quran that all of the prophets, when they prayed, they bowed down, they put their forehead on the floor. And Abraham went forth and he threw himself on the floor and glorified the Lord. And Moses grabbed Aaron and they washed themselves. And he said, let's purify ourselves, let's wash ourselves like our Lord ordered us. And then they went into the tent and they bowed down and prayed. And Jesus, peace be upon him, when he was tempted by Satan and he got away from him, the first, he threw himself on the ground, forehead on the floor, and prayed. And Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, Sallu, kama ra'aytumuni usalli, pray as you have seen me pray. And the way he taught us is by bowing down and praying. So we find that there is no contradiction. We follow the prophets by the letter, the way they prayed, the way they fasted, the way they worshiped. None of them ever said, ask me and I would ask God. But instead they said, ask God. And they taught us the way to pray. Los profetas que la paz y bendición de Dios son con él, ellos todos nos enseñaron a adorar a Dios como Dios les ordenó. Y todos, por ejemplo, todos en las Escrituras vemos que nos adoraban a Dios de una manera, ¿verdad? Y no hay contradicción. Abraham, cuando rezaba, ponía su rostro en el suelo. Moisés le dijo a Aarón, a su hermano, vamos a purificarnos como Dios nos ordenó. y vamos a y cuando entraron se tiraron al suelo y rezaron con su rostro en el suelo. Jesús, cuando fue tentado por Satanás y se alejó de él, se tiró en el suelo y le rezó a Dios. Entonces, hay una armonía en la manera en que todos los profetas rezaron. Y es decir, si nos preguntamos si yo verdaderamente sigo a Moisés, ¿por qué no rezo como Moisés? Si yo verdaderamente sigo a Jesús, ¿por qué no rezo como Jesús? ¿Verdad? Si yo verdaderamente sigo a Mohammed, ¿por qué no rezo como Mohammed? El profeta Mohammed no vino a traer un mensaje de rechazar a los profetas, sino vino con un mensaje para toda la humanidad, porque Dios dice que Él va a enviar un profeta para la humanidad. Y le digo a la audiencia que miren al versículo y busquen que dice un versículo cuando Jesús se le preguntó, ¿tú eres el profeta para los mundos? Y él dijo, no, yo fui solamente enviado para las ovejas de Israel. So Jesus, peace be upon him, said, was asked in the Bible, please look it up, are you the prophet for the world? And he said, no, I was only sent for the children of Israel. Now, when we look at Isaiah 42, verse 1 to 13, God talks about a prophet, descendant of Ishmael, okay?
Yeah.
Who will speak to the Gentiles, who will come for the Gentiles, and the Gentiles are any other people that are not from the children of Israel.
Yes.
And this prophet will come with a different song, with a different revelation, okay? So we believe that this is talking about Prophet Muhammad because it's talking to the Gentiles. Now, in el libro de Isaías 42, versículo 1, hasta versículo 13. Vemos cuando se le preguntó a Jesús, ¿acaso tú eres el profeta para los mundos? Él dijo, no, yo fui solamente enviado para las ovejas perdidas de Israel. Y en el capítulo 42, 1 al 13 de Isaías, Dios habla para ustedes, todos los que no son de Israel son gentiles, y este profeta es descendiente de Ismael. Y se menciona en esos versículos que los habitantes de Kedar, de Parán, de Arabia, que sean felices. Y ese profeta vendrá con una nueva canción, ¿verdad? Entonces vemos que Dios envió al profeta Muhammad cuando Dios le dice a él, and this is to conclude, Dios le dice, قولوا آمنا بما أنزل إلينا وما أنزل إلى إبراهيم وإسماعيل وإسحاق ويعقوب والأسباط وما أوتي موسى وعيسى وما أوتي النبيون من ربهم لا نفرق بين أحد ونحن له مسلمون. Allah says, believe in that, and in that which was revealed to Abraham, and that which was revealed to Ishmael, Isaac, Jacob, and the 12 sons of Jacob, the tribes of Jacob, and say, you believe in what was given to Moses, the Old Testament, the Torah, and what was given to Jesus, the New Testament, the Evangelical. And you believe in all of the prophets from the Lord. You make no distinction among them, and you submit to God, and we submit to God's will. Dios le enseñó al profeta Muhammad, di, creemos en lo que se nos reveló a nosotros, el Corán. Y lo que se le reveló a Abraham, a Ismael, a Isaac, y a Jacob, y a las tribus de Jacob. Y creemos en lo que se le reveló a Moisés, la Torah. el Viejo Testamento, y lo que se le reveló a Jesús, el Evangelio. Creemos en todos los profetas del Señor. No hacemos distinción entre uno ni otro, y nos entregamos por completo a la voluntad de Dios.
With your permission, Imam, alhamdulillah, this is a beautiful, beautiful topic that we're speaking about, the mercy of Prophet Muhammad. And we are told in the Quran in chapter 21, verse 107, and we, God is speaking, have not sent you, O Muhammad, except as a mercy for mankind. This is what the Imam is talking about. He talks about the mercy of Prophet Muhammad, mercy to all mankind, mercy to even animals and everything. Do we have a call?
So let me translate this verse.
Before the translation, we're signal that we have another caller. Go ahead, caller.
Oh, good side.
Hello?
Assalamualaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. Welcome to Islam for Mankind. Yes, sir.
Thank you. This is Imam Azhar. How are you?
Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, Imam Azhar. Go ahead, Imam, your life, inshallah.
So I just want to thank you for taking me on the show, and I apologize for the background noise. I want to thank you for the program. The program is going great. And our efforts are to try to bring humanity together under the model that our Prophet Muhammad SAW taught us, is that the human beings are very important. They're Allah's creation, and we cannot hurt anyone in trying to bring unity. So unity entails everyone working together in a collaborative fashion for the betterment of the common good. And we see today in our country that there is so much disruption, there is so much disconnect, and there's dissatisfaction. And there has to be a solution to that. And I hope and I pray that all of us will come together and devise a solution that could make us love each other once more, work together, and make our country strong and united, and make our world a more prosperous and peaceful place.
That's well said. That's exactly the essence and the message of Islam that you've spoken about, mercy to mankind. Because the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, whoever believes in Allah and the last day should not hurt his neighbor, and whoever believes in Allah and the last day should serve his guest generously, and whoever believes in Allah and the last day should speak what is good and keep quiet. We're going to go ahead with the translation, and Imam, you can stay with us, inshallah. Go ahead, sure. Imam Hernandez, go ahead with the translation, inshallah. Jazakumullah.
Allah dice, y no te enviamos, oh Muhammad, excepto que como una misericordia para la humanidad. We have not sent you except as a mercy to the worlds. Now, I wanted to, mashallah, jazakallah khair, Imam, for the input and regarding coexistence.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Working together for the common good and for humanity, because as human beings, you know, we are all vicegerents of God upon the earth, and even the earth, we have to take care of the earth because it's alive, and every creature we have a responsibility towards, right? And we can benefit from them as well. But the reality is, I want to bring it from a world perspective to a local perspective. And this is my advice. My advice is that at a local level, we should develop not a yearly meeting with our neighbors, but we should develop a relationship. Right, we should develop a relationship where we interact with one another, right, at a local level, because that's the biggest impact that we make, is at a local level. Sometimes when we talk about national level, we forget, and we're neglecting our local neighbors, because there is a mention in Islam about your nearest neighbors. So therefore, we need to build interfaith relationships with the churches, with the synagogues, with the temples, and build from there for this, with a clear intention that we are only working together for the benefit of the city or the town, and we don't have a right to force Islam upon you, right? And we don't want nothing in return, right? We take it from the Quran, لا إكراه في الدين, We take it from the Quran. لا نريد منكم جزاء ولا شكورا. We want no reward, no thanks. We're doing it because we fear Allah and we have to do it. So correct. Mi consejo es que el esfuerzo debe ser local. Y entre nosotros tenemos que hacer el esfuerzo de visitarnos unos a otros, mezquitas, iglesias, templos, para conocernos y para tratar, para esforzarnos en mantener el bienestar de nuestra ciudad, de nuestros pueblos, y esforzarnos, porque si no, nos enfocamos nacionalmente y localmente no nos conocemos. Y la persona teme lo que no conoce. The person fears what he doesn't know. So neighbor, sometimes, you know, and this is the truth. I mean, I used to live in a neighborhood, and there was an non-Muslim that I met. She lived next to the mosque 10 years. She didn't even know it was a mosque.
So, see, the thing I want to just interject here, I totally understand what you're saying and how you're trying to present this. The coexistence factor is there, and we need it ever so more today than, you know, ever before in our history. The thing is that I think we have to all trust one another in order to try to build that relationship. I believe when my Christian brothers and sisters, my Jewish brothers and sisters are coming out to meet with us, they don't have an agenda of converting us. In the same fashion, the Muslims are not going out there to actively convert people. And let it be said straight, let us set the record straight, Islam is not about converting people. The Prophet Muhammad was told in the Quran, you can't guide who you want. That's God's job. But your job is to bring forth common understanding, let people understand the alternative view. Today, people fear Islam because the positive voice and the voice to counter the negative voice is not out there. As you said, we need to build those relationships strong, not on an annual basis. What my vision is that beyond introduction and understanding and friendship is that we as people of faith, we as people of the city, we as people of the community can tackle issues related to us together. You know, we could come together and say there's homelessness. How could we resolve this thing? And you're so right about the politics issue, because what we learned in this political cycle this year is that local politics affects us more than national. So if we want betterment and change, it's not going to happen by a politician alone. We all need to work and make sure our voices are heard as to what our concerns are and what we want done, so that our politicians can make that a priority.
Jazakumullah khairan. We thank both Imam Azhar and Imam Hernandez, and we thank our audience. The show come a close, and invite you both, inshallah, next week we will have a Christian that Imam Azhar invited last week. Ezra, he's going to be with us next week, and we will talk about racism, and we would like to hear the Christian and the Islamic perspective, and what is more uplifting, to hear it from two imams, their perspective. And this is not reflecting just from a personal view. This is reflective of what Islam has to bring into the table. And we thank you both, Imam, and we thank the audience. And for those who have joined us, this is Islam for Mankind, your weekly radio. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. And also we thank Radio La Primera 1220. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum.
Ríos, el concierto.
¿Quieres ser enfermera o enfermero en este nuevo